All right, let's see if this works. It may just be a setting, I don't know. Oh,
That's
that
what
works
works.
better. Wow,
I feel
okay, that works better. Thank you.
you are.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Praise God. All right, people, how you're doing? How you're doing? Come on, come on on, come on, come on. Good evening. Good evening, everybody. Good evening. Can they make me like a cup of tea, please? Let me tell them to make me a cup of tea. Everybody, come on. Praise God, praise God. May I have a cup of tea, please? All right, let me see if I get a response. Patricia Coltman, wow, nice to see you here. Jacqueline Cornelius, nice to see you here. Willis Tice, Washington. Oh, I got a response. It says sure. Sure. So at some point, I'm gonna ask my wife and Seven to come here. Believe it or not, I am opening, I am telling everybody everything. A little lotion, please. A little lotion for my face. How y'all doing? Welcome, 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 welcome tonight. Welcome tonight. Before I pray, please go ahead and share. And then I'm gonna go ahead and get into this. All right. Go ahead and get into it. So let's do that. Lord, we give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. Let your name truly be glorified in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen and amen and amen. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Go ahead and just share, 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 share. How y'all doing? How has your weekend been? Ours has been amazing. We're actually supposed to be here until Tuesday, but I think we're going to be leaving first thing tomorrow morning. All is well. We just want to leave first thing tomorrow morning. There are a few things we have to get done. A lot to do before camp, so we want to rush back and just get some of those things done. But go ahead and tune in. Delore, it's nice to see you. Donna Mitzi, nice to see you. Shanta Hogan Walker, nice to see you. Stephanie Park, nice to see you. How you doing? Tabitha Yonts, how you doing? Chukwueka Jones, nice to see you all. Praise God, praise God, praise God. It's nice to see you all. Really excited about the word tonight. Really, really excited about the word tonight. We're going to continue. I'm getting a lot of testimonies that a lot of people are being blessed by that teaching on the subject of faith. Believe it or not, we're beginning to pray and believe God when we're going to literally start our M633 Academy so that we can really come to your own area and do like an all-day Saturday training in the Word of God, and then maybe have a miracle service that particular night so you all can see the demonstration of the power of God. But I'm really excited about tonight. We're here in Nashville, Tennessee, celebrating, of course, Brittany's birthday. As you all know, she means a lot to Kelly. She means a lot to the ministry. She means a lot to her family. So we wanted to take out that time and just kind of celebrate her, you know? And so that's what we've been doing since we got here, just celebrating her. An amazing, amazing time we've had here. So let me see. Let's go ahead and pray right now and get ready to share the word of God. Father, we just want to say thank you. Thanks a million for your grace. Thank you for all that you've done, all that you've accomplished. Let your name truly be glorified. We're so excited about tonight. Spirit of the living God, have your way. Speak to your people, minister to your people. We just decree by faith that not a single person who has tuned in or will be tuning in will leave the same way that they came. Breathe upon this life-giving word to produce within us all that is required for this season in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody says amen. Navisa, nice to see you. Avatoas, nice to see you. See Ryan Yontz, nice to see you. Adriana Olivia, nice to see you. Oliver, I hope I'm pronouncing these names right. Nice to see you all. Welcome, 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 welcome. We're going to continue along the lines, the series that we started on since the last time. Hey, Bo.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Thank you so much. You want to come say hi to the people? We're just being very bare. Oh. Love what you got on. When did you get that?
Hi, people.
Hello, everybody. See, I'm putting some lotion. My face is kind of a bit dry. Doesn't
it
look dry?
I noticed that. You're looking kind of ashy.
I know, right?
Oh, y'all yeah, good
that's,
tonight?
That's better now. That's better. That's better. Okay. Just doing that, you know. I told my wife I'm going to start growing out my hair the way I used to grow it out. You know, people have kind of asked me, what is this knot you got on your head here? What is all that stuff there?
That's where I hit him.
No. What it is... actually, when I was in high school, right? Do I need to tell that story
right
now?
Yeah, tell it. It's funny. Well, it probably wasn't funny then, but it's funny now.
Yeah. So I was in high school, and I don't remember.
Brittany's Cash App is B, Barry, R. Somebody asked.
Okay, somebody asked. So anyway, you know, back, I don't know how it is here in the U.S. In Africa, you have, you know, I was somewhere around, I don't know what to call it. You know, you'll call it grades here, but I was in
high school.
In high school. About my third year in high school, class three, during my time, we only did it 5 years. They're doing it 6 years now, what they call JSS Junior and JSS Senior. So you know, this girl came and said, whether I liked it or not, you know, I'm going to be her pet. That's the word that was used back in those days. I'm like, your pet? You got to be kidding me. She said, well, I'm saying it right now. Whether you like it or not, you're going to be my pet. What they mean is you're going to be my
like
boyfriend. Even though I'm older than you, you're going to be my boyfriend in school. And it was by fire or by force. Like, whether you like it or not, that's what's going to happen. So I'm like, nope, that's not going to happen. So one day I was somewhere in the hall, and she just came running, like, just charged toward me. So in my bid to turn and run, man, there was a metal pole right there. And the next thing I had was boom.
Oh, I know that hurt.
And this thing just began to swell. A friend of mine tried to press it in, but it was so painful. I couldn't really endure the pain. So that's why it's there. But you notice, all my friends have never known that I had this bump here. The reason is because I had hair. So the hair would cover it, right? So the hair would cover it, and because the hair covered it, did you see it when you first saw me?
No, it wasn't.
Yeah.
13 years later.
Yeah, you know, so I had hair, so the hair would cover it. But now, you know, I go with this low cut that Kaylee likes so much.
I think it's
if it was up to her, she would have me shave this whole hair off. And so that's why you're seeing that bump. So what I want to do is I want to grow it back just a little bit more, okay, and then, you know, be my original self again. Mm-hmm. What you think?
I think the night is fine.
All right.
Bye,
so,
y'all.
All right. So, I won't be long. Okay. I won't be long. I know they have to go out and they want to go eat. So I'll be here with Seven.
For Brittany's birthday.
You know, doing the men thing. I'm gonna take, you know, the boys be hanging out while the girls go do their dinner. All right. So I got some African food in the fridge.
That's the real reason, y'all. Because he got some African food already. I'll bring your tea back.
All right, boo. Thank you so much. All right, thank you. Okay. You're gonna bring Seven? They want to see Seven later.
Yeah,
you don't want to see Seven?
I bring them in about 20 minutes.
Okay, be careful down the stairs.
Okay.
All right, people. So let's begin. Now, we began to talk about last week, how can you tell when your faith is robust, when your faith is alive, when your faith is at work, when your faith is at its apex, right? When you got what I call maximum faith, great faith, faith that is just explosive faith. How can you tell? And I got the response that so many people were blessed. Honestly, this is the response I got from each and every one of you. And then Kayla and I came back and we actually talked about this during one of the morning videos. I believe it was last Friday. We talked about faith is the victory, kind of reemphasizing some of the things I talked about the night before, the Sunday night before then. I think what really resonated with a lot of you was comparing faith to a pregnant woman, comparing faith to pregnancy. The same tangible activities that happen when a woman is pregnant is synonymous with what would happen to you when you're pregnant with a specific part of the word, whether you're working on your health and then you're planting, you know, those healing seeds or health seeds inside your spirit, or whether it's something that has to do with your success or finances, whatever it is that you are believing God for, an area of life you want to see really improve very significantly, you're going to have to develop your faith in that area. And I talked about how, you know, in the scriptures, four times from Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 4, the way to the book of Hebrews, the scriptures emphasized again and again, the just shall live by faith, the just shall live by faith, the just shall live by faith. It may be the only place in all of the Bible where you have the same emphasis made four times.
It's,
thank you, boo.
It's hot.
Okay.
It's good.
Thank you so much. Perfect.
Okay.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. You know, where the emphasis is made like four solid times, right? Now, so the Bible is telling us we have to live by faith, right? So developing your faith is crucial. I'm telling you right now, it is the one thing you need to give yourself to, the one thing you need to commit your life to, because without faith, it is impossible to please God, right? It's impossible to really please God. So I really, 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 really want to encourage you all to develop your faith in that area. But how can you tell? Because there are a lot of people who really don't know how to tell when they're in faith. They don't know the difference. They just feel like, well, you know, I'm a born-again Christian. I go to church. I do all the right things. I live right. That equals to me living, you know, I've got to have faith. I mean, what do you mean I don't have faith, right? But it's really important that you understand if you've got faith or not. If you've got faith, if you have the kind of faith that is required to bring to pass all that you're believing God for. So let's go back to that Mark chapter number four. Okay, Mark chapter number four. Let's go back there. Let me open my own scriptures. Mark chapter number four. Mark 4, beginning again at verses, I believe it's 26. Let me open there, okay? Yes, verse 26. And let me see. I've never read this in the TPT. Just give me a second. Let me browse through it, okay? Okay, okay. All right. I love what the TPT says here. So it says, Jesus also told them this parable. God's kingdom realm. That's why I was telling you from the beginning that the phrase kingdom of God there is not speaking about heaven or going to heaven. It simply means the operations of God, the way God functions, the way God operates. God's kingdom realm is like someone spreading seed on the ground. He goes to bed and gets up day after day, and the seed sprouts and grows tall, though he knows not how. Verse 28, all by itself it sprouts, and the soil produces a crop. I've said this so many times, that your seed is at the mercy of the soil. Your seed is at the mercy of the soil. I want to say that again. Your seed is at the mercy of the soil, and every seed has its own peculiar soil or a particular soil. Every seed doesn't thrive in all types of soil. You need to know the kind of soil that is conducive for the kind of seed that you're sowing, okay? That's another message for another time, right? But the point I want to emphasize here is this. It says, all by itself, verse 28, I'm reading in the TPT, it sprouts and the soil produces a crop. First, the green stem or the leaf, or what the King James calls the blade. Then it says, then the head on the stalk. That's the ear in the corn. The ear, when it's beginning to form, it's still a baby corn, right? Then it says, and then the fully developed grain in the head. Verse 29, then when the grain is ripe, he immediately puts the sickle to the grain because the harvest time has come. And this is just something, brothers and sisters, you're going to have to know when your faith is ripened. When your faith is timed to be harvested, okay? When it's time to harvest your faith, pluck your faith because it's ripened. We're talking about ripened faith, matured faith, fully developed faith, the kind that moves God, the kind that works. It's a fully matured faith, a fully developed faith, a fully ripened faith, just like the fruit. Remember, when I was growing up in Africa, many of you may have not known this, in the very compound where I grew up, that's the particular compound right now where I'm almost done building a house for my mom, the same compound, that's where I grew up as a kid in Africa. My father planted a lot of fruit trees in that compound, and it's very acidic to the teeth when you're trying to eat unripened fruit, you know, unripened, say, pineapple, unripened mango. I don't know if many of you are familiar with the mango fruit. We have several different types of mango fruits in Africa. There were so many fruit trees that we had in our compound, and it's very acidic, very corrosive to the teeth, in a sense, very acidic to the teeth when it's unripened. So we've got to wait till your faith in that area, the area that you want to see results, okay? The key is you've got to develop your faith in that area. I'm telling you right now, money is spiritual. Money is not just physical. Jesus put it this way: if you haven't been faithful with the unrighteous mammon, the unrighteous mammon, the word mammon there simply means the spirit of money. Okay, there are spirits that control that world, right? Believe it or not, there are spirits that control that world. That is why some of these Hollywood folks or artists or people in the music industry tend to sell their soul to the devil in exchange for wealth and influence. I'm telling you right now, it happens on a daily basis. No need pretending it doesn't, because it does, right? So the spirit of mammon, if you haven't been faithful with money, how can God even trust you with the true riches, right? So he's given us a revelation that money is not just physical, money is spiritual. Right? And the spiritual governs the natural. Please, you're a believer right now, and you've got to learn how to make use of your own weapons. You have to know how to work the system of the kingdom of God. The people of the world understand how to work the world's system, but you and I, we're going to have to learn how to work the system of the kingdom of God. You've got to work it. And part of working the system of the kingdom of God is an understanding of how things are designed to work in the kingdom. For the believer, the spiritual governs the natural. Again, the spiritual governs the natural. The spiritual creates the natural. Okay? So the goal is for you to leverage your faith and take command of the realm of the spirit, or take command of the spirit world. Why? So that you can dominate in the physical world. That's just the way our system works. You have to rule the supernatural to rule the natural, right? It takes light to rule the day, and it takes the lesser light to rule the night, the greater light to rule the day. So I'm saying this to say, as believers, you have to become familiar. You have to become a really trained swordsman, somebody who has been taught to leverage the sword of the spirit. You need to know how to use your faith in a way that really produces profound results, right? The key is you have to develop your faith. Any area you want to command dominion, any area you want to have victory, any area you want to take mastery over, okay, you want to become a boss in the spirit. I love that phrase. I'm beginning to love that phrase. How many of you are saying, I want to be a boss in the spirit? Yeah, I want to be a boss when it comes to these specific areas of my life. Then you've got to begin in the realm of the supernatural, the realm of the spiritual, because the spiritual governs the natural. Okay, the spiritual governs the natural. And once you win in the realm of faith, you win in the realm of life. Once you win in the realm of faith, you win in the realm of life. I'm saying this to say, So the Bible is telling us that, you know, you have to go after ripened faith, matured faith, a fully developed faith. Until it's fully developed, you can't harvest it. You can't put it in the sickle, right? It's got to be fully developed. So how do you know when that's happening? And we kind of walked you through this whole thing, just like a pregnant woman when she conceives, okay? She's got that first trimester, the second trimester, then the third trimester. But, you know, we've got somebody now, part of our staff, the Warrior Nation staff, I'm not going to mention her name, that is pregnant, right? Most of you may not know her. Her name is actually Kat, and she's pregnant. Her and her husband have been believing God for a child, and now she's pregnant. All she talks about is her baby in the womb. Every time I see her in the office, all that Kat can talk about is my baby, this pregnancy. And you notice that people who are pregnant, that's really all they talk about. That's the talk that trumps every other conversation that they have. They're constantly telling you everything they're experiencing in the pregnancy. It's almost like they can't talk about any other subject outside of what they've been experiencing with their own pregnancy. And so that's what I was telling you last Sunday. You can't be pregnant and not know it. Hello now. Barada leke brakata leke. You can't be pregnant with healing and not know that healing life is flowing through you. You can't be pregnant with something and not know it, right? And I've told you this. This is how you know if all the activities that happen in a woman who is pregnant with a baby in the natural, because all truth is parallel. That means what is true in the natural is also true in the supernatural. For example, the earth is a microcosm of the heavens. The earth, believe it or not, it's a reflection of the heavens, right? One is supernatural, one is natural. One is spiritual, one is natural. But what is true, the laws that pertain here, you can find them also there. Now, so in the kingdom of God, right, the key is what? You've got to know how to develop your faith. Any area you are still suffering in, you have a lot of challenge in that area. The reason is you have not fully developed your faith. Remember, faith is the victory. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Faith is the victory. In fact, let me read that to you now. Okay, let me read that to you quickly. Faith is the victory. I want to read it in the Message translation. I love how the Message puts it. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. That's 1 John 5:4. And you've got to settle this, brothers and sisters. Faith is the victory. Don't let anybody else tell you otherwise. Let the word of God speak for itself. 1 John 5:4. 1 John 5:4. Notice what it says in the Message translation. Every God-born person conquers the world's ways. The conquering power, you see it? That brings the world to its knees is our faith. The conquering power that brings the world to its knees. Faith always wins. Living faith cannot be denied. Living faith cannot be ignored. Living faith cannot be overlooked. Living faith always wins. Believe this. There are people who say, let's take, for example, the subject of cancer. We've had a lot of loved ones, you know, like Kelly, for example, our own mom, died from that terrible sickness, right? And so you hear people often say, well, you know, I was believing God for it, but it didn't happen. And that kind of gives the body of Christ the illusion that there are some things that God can't handle, you know, or it kind of paints the picture like you win in some things or you don't win in some things. It paints the picture of maybe it wasn't God's will. You see that? It wasn't God's will for this person to be healed. And so a lot of God's people begin to walk in some sort of confusion because they don't have a settled doctrine. They don't have a settled understanding. They don't know. Well, you know, now that this person is sick or this person has cancer, how can we even tell if they're going to recover from this? How can we tell if this person is going to recover? How can we tell if it's God's will for this person to recover or not to recover? So there's a lot of confusion around that. And I'm telling you right now, please, for your own sake, for your own soul, settle this. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. That means there is nothing that this world will throw at you. There are no diseases that strong that faith cannot cannot overpower. There is no cancer in the universe that faith cannot overcome. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. This is what the issue is. Sometimes people have not fully developed their faith in that specific area. How can you tell when you've developed your faith in a specific area or not? I'm telling you right now, there are people who have not worked on the word sufficient enough to develop the kind of faith that keeps them in victory. I want to say that again. A lot of people who have not spent sufficient time in the word to develop the kind of faith that keeps them in victory over that particular case. I'm telling you right now, please, you know, this is truly the word of God. For example, in Genesis 8, verse 22, let's go there. Let me show you a few things there. Genesis 8, 22. I feel like I'm preaching to the choir. I feel like you guys understand this. Genesis 8, 22. Notice what it says. Let me read this in the King James Version. Okay, let me read this in the King James Version. That's Genesis 8, 22. And it says, while the earth remaineth. So this is a law in the kingdom of God. While the earth remains, seed, time, and harvest. You see that? Seed, time, and harvest. Cold and heat. Summer and winter. Day and night shall not cease. These are laws in the earth realm. Okay? You cannot fast the darkness away. The dark will come. It will get dark. After 12 hours, it will get dark. After another 12 hours, the sun will rise. Hello now, right? There will always be summer and winter. Okay, you're not going to not have a season where you don't have summer. It don't matter how much you pray, how much you fast. These are established. The Bible calls this the fixed ordinances of heaven and earth, the fixed ordinances of God. The fixed laws, okay? You can't fast it away. Cold and heat, okay? We are approaching winter right now. In some areas, it's actually really cold. You can't fast the winter away. It's a law. You can't circumvent it, right? The same time, you have to look at the seed time. Seed time. Seed time. The key word there is time. 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 Think about it this way. In the natural, we have to teach our kids to save. We have to build wealth for our children when they are young. You know what I mean? There are just some things, once you kind of miss the timing, it takes a miracle to buy back that time. It takes a miracle to redeem back that time. Right, so everybody who is in the finance world will tell you, listen, man, you want to build a great retirement. And I'm just talking like the world right now. You want to build a great retirement, you need to start early. Some things you've got to start early. Hello now. You get what I'm saying? You've got to start early. It's the same thing with the word. Train up a child in the way he should go. How do you train them? In the word. You disciple them in the word. You get it? So when it says seed time, and harvest, seed time. Seed time is the timing factor. The timing factor. And it takes time to develop faith. Why? Because faith is a lifestyle. That means it never goes out of style. It never goes out of fashion. Okay, you can't say, well, you know, I'm 30 years old, I've stopped developing my faith. You never stop developing. It's like somebody coming and saying, I've stopped breathing. You can't stop breathing. You stop breathing, you die. Hello now. The just shall live by. The just shall live by. It's from faith to faith. Romans 1:17, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. As it is written, it says, therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. So faith is a lifestyle. Say that with me. Faith is a lifestyle. That means as long as you have breath in your lungs, you need to live by faith. Your faith needs to be explosive, robust. And let me tell you something about faith again. Faith is very specific. That means just because you got it going on in this specific area may not mean that you got it going on in all areas. In other words, you're going to have to develop your faith in very specific areas. So once you finish with one area, you start the next one. Once you start with the next one, you start with the next one. For example, some of you watching me tonight, you need to develop your faith in the area of finances. Hello now. That's a big, big one for the body of Christ, right? You need to develop your faith even in the area of relationships. You need to develop your faith even in the area of marriage. You need to develop your faith in the area of in the area of miracle signs and wonders, in the area of the supernatural. So there are very specific areas. Whatever area you have a challenge in, you know, you need to learn how to develop your faith in that area. It takes time. Seed, time, and then harvest. Seed, time, and then harvest. And so Jesus put it this way. Okay, Jesus put it this way. Time, in fact, let me show it to you so you know I'm not just quoting scriptures off my head. You know, let me show it to you so you can appreciate this. Go with me to Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 17. I want you to see the tenses Jesus uses. Okay, you got to pay attention to those tenses. Luke chapter 17. All right. Luke chapter 17. Beginning at verses 5. I'm reading this from the King James Version. Just go with me to the King James Version. Luke 17 verses 5, let me show you the tenses. Pay attention to what Jesus said. The apostles, this is Luke 17 verses 5, reading into verses 6. And the apostles said unto the Lord, increase our faith. That's what they were asking him to do. Lord, increase our faith. Increase our faith. Now, notice how Jesus responded in verses 6. And the Lord said, If ye had it already, not if you're going to have it, not that you're trying to start developing your faith. Faith needs to be in place before the problem arises. Faith needs to be in place. Faith comes first before the problem arises, so that when the problem arises, you can now use your faith and deal with that problem. We put the cart before the horse. We start developing our faith after the problem has arrived. We start developing our faith during the problem, during the time when the problem has already arisen. So Jesus puts it this way. Okay, somebody left their phone here. All right, so that's what the issue is. You're now developing your faith in the middle of the problem. You're developing your faith while you're in the problem. You're developing your faith after the problem has showed up. It may be late. It may be late. I'm not saying you can't develop your faith after, because you can. I'm not saying that you can't develop your faith during, because you can. But if you follow what Jesus was teaching, he said, if you had faith already as a grain of mustard seed, if you had it, that means faith needs to be in place before the problem arises. You see it? You see it now? That's a revelation for some of you listening to this tonight, right? And so the timing may be late. The timing it would take to develop your faith, right? And I believe this is a big reason why God's people die of cancer. This is why. This is why many do not recover. This is why many do not regain their health. They started late. It's late. And I know it's not coming across like good news, but it's the truth. This is why the just shall live. The just shall live. Faith is what, people? A lifestyle. It's not something you tune on and tune off when you feel like it. You've got to keep your faith alive. That is a personal responsibility. You've got to keep it going. You've got to keep your faith active all times, because you just know, you don't know the evil day. The Bible says, haven't done all to stand there. Therefore, you don't know the evil day. The evil day, you say, what is the evil day? The evil day is just the day that all hell has decided they want to make your life miserable. There are times when demons target you. There are times when demons, particularly when they smell that God wants to do something huge through you, when they smell the aroma, the fragrance of God's grace on your life, or that God, you know, or they smell the fragrance of some divine promotion coming your way, then all of hell decides they're knocking on your door that day. You know what I mean? That's the evil day. Now, if the enemy hits you and you're unprepared, hello now, that's, you know, warfare 101, 101, warfare 101. You take the enemy, by, the way you win wars is when you take the enemy by surprise. Hello now. So these demons and the devil take God's people by surprise because they're unprepared. You know, you can be the strongest military force in the world, but if you're unprepared, the weakest enemies can defeat you. You know, so if your faith is not active, it means you're unprepared to deal with the challenges that may hit you, boom, before you even know what's happening, you're hit. And then you're wondering, where did this cancer come from? Where did it come from? In fact, let me show you something. Did you know the strongest battle you're ever going to fight? Let me say this, and then I'm going to pray for you. I'm gonna use this coming Sunday to drive this thing home. I'm gonna tabernacle here for a minute, but just give me a few more minutes. Let me show you something here. There is no such thing as fighting demons. That we're not called to fight demons. No. 1,000 times no. You're not called to fight the devil. Absolutely not. Why? Because the devil is a defeated foe. Please hear me now. You don't fight defeated enemies. You don't fight a conquered enemy. You don't fight. What is there to fight? There's nothing to fight. I think we get confused with this word we call when we wrestle against principalities and powers. So you see a wrestling match, you think that's what the Bible is. That word wrestle doesn't mean that at all, right? So I know this. I told you my story when I was in college. I got tired of how the enemy was being blamed for so many things, and every little thing, the devil, every little thing, people were giving him props where he doesn't even deserve it. So I went into a 2-week fast, locked myself in, God is my witness. Didn't see that sunlight for 2 solid weeks. What was I doing? I wanted to know the authority of Satan. That was my goal for that fast. Can you imagine? This is how you need to be about the word. You need to be serious about your Christian walk, right? So I gave myself for 2 weeks fasting and praying, not a morsel of bread in my body, fasting and praying. I said, God, reveal to me the authority of Satan. Now, I went in thinking this dude had some authority, right? Because I felt like, okay, since he's the king of the dark world, whatever is happening that is of darkness is under his authority. So if I can figure out where he is, on a scale of 0 to 10, then I know how to deal with this enemy. I'm telling you, after 2 weeks of searching scripture, praying and fasting, searching page from Genesis to Revelation, I came out and I discovered one truth that has set me free for so many years. You say, Pastor Sino, what is that truth? His authority is less than minus zero. Is less than minus. It's not even zero. It's minus zero. I came out knowing Satan is a conquered foe. He is a conquered enemy. Satan has no power. In fact, Satan has zero power. Listen, listen. I know you. Many of you, you know, you get into all these witches and wizards. They want to give you the idea that they have power. And the weapon they use is fear. Let me drink my tea. You know, so particularly in Africa, all these, what they call these juju priests and native doctors and people who consult demonic shrines. Jesus said, all power. I've been teaching this for years. All power in heaven and on earth. So what's left? All power. All power? Yes, all power. So what's left? You see, the enemy, listen. There is nothing Satan can do to you without your consent. Barada leke braka. He needs your consent to hurt you. He needs your consent to infect you. He needs you to collaborate or cooperate on some level for him to gain entrance. Satan has no power. Zero, less than zero. Satan doesn't just have zero power. Less than zero. If there's anything like that, it's minus zero. Man, my authority after I discovered that truth went through the roof. That's when I stopped praying for sick people. You say, Pastor, what do you mean? I stopped praying because I began to see things from a whole different dimension. Like, I just gave instructions. That's all I did. You know, go, you're healed. Be loosed, you're free. Death, lose him. Cancer, go. I started giving orders. Because faith, real faith, makes you a boss in the spirit. Real faith makes you a boss, a commander. You commandeer the spirit world. Okay? Now, so how does he infect God's people? Let me show it to you. It's very simple. I don't think you've seen it, but let me show it to you very quickly. Man, I feel this anointing coming, and then I'm going to just let you guys go. Next Sunday, just prepare. We're going to travel. These are the things I'm longing to come among you and teach. I want, when we start healing school, I want to be in the midst of you all. You take your Bible. I say, open here. You open. We read it together. We dissect it. We meditate on it. I'm telling you, it's going to be really explosive. God, please open this door all across the United States of America. This Faith Academy, this healing school, please, God, let the wind of the Spirit blow upon it. Bring faith. You said when you came back to the earth, will you find faith in the earth? Will you find this kind of a faith in the earth? God, I'm praying you are waking our faith. So let me show it to you very quickly, and then I'll let you go. Matthew chapter 6. I'm not sure you've seen it this way, so let me show it to you. Matthew chapter 6. Jesus repeats this word twice. Notice what it says in verse 25 and verse 28. In fact, let's read it. We see it again, all right? Let's begin in verse 25. Man, I fear the anointing. You want to read it in the King James Version, please go to the King James Version. Quickly, go there with me. I want to show you how the enemy gains access to God's people. He knows he has no power. Now, what he has left are tricks. What he has left is what the scriptures in Ephesians chapter 6 calls strategies. He's got strategies. He's got cunning devices. The Bible says we're not ignorant of his devices. He's got methodologies. He's got, the King James calls it the wiles of the devil, the cunning devices of the devil. All he's got left with is tricks. Most of them are not even new. They're so old. They go back to the beginning of time. Now, in Matthew chapter 6, this is how he gains access. Look at verse 25. Therefore, I say unto you, take no thought. Take no thought. Take no thought. Thoughts can be taken. Baradokata leke branaka. All right, let me show it to you again. Look again in verses 27. I'm reading this in the King James Version. Which of you by taking thought, you can take a thought. You can take a thought. Look at verse 28. Matthew 6, 28. And why take ye thought? Why take ye thought? You see it? Why take ye thought? Go all the way to verse 31. You see how many times this has been repeated? Therefore, take no thought. Hello now. Okay? Again in verse 34. Take therefore no thought. So this is what the enemy does. The enemy knows how to flash images in your thought life. He knows how to inject demonic pictures into your head. So this is what happens. You see, you feel a pain. Okay, there's a pain. Watch this now. There is a pain that you're feeling on your lower abdomen. Okay, and that pain begins to thrive and you feel it and you say, oh my God, what is this? Then you look it up in, you Google it and they say, well, you know, if you got pain in the lower abdomen, it may be that you are now beginning to have cancer. Notice what it says, take no thought. So what the enemy is going to use, he's going to use your own mouth against you. His weapon is your own words. Let me show it to you. Let me show it to you. Let me show it to you. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. Just go with me. I'm almost rounding off. Okay. Matthew chapter 12. Let me show it to you very quickly. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. I want to show it to you. I want to show it to you quickly. Verse 37. By your own words shall thou be justified, and by your words shall thou be condemned. In fact, if you read it in the book of Proverbs, it says, thou art ensnared by the words of your own mouth. So the enemy, he waits for you by flashing images. So you feel a pain here. All of a sudden you're thinking, well, you know, my grandmama had cancer, my mother before, after her had cancer, maybe I'm beginning to develop something. And then he waits for you to use your own mouth and what? And take that thought. You know, he's now using tricks and devices and images, and he's showing you things. The reason why this pain has been here now for 3 days is there is something badly wrong with you. He begins to point you in all directions, and the goal is to convince you that you've got something you don't even have. Until you take the thought will not manifest until you take it. How do you take thoughts? You take it with the words of your mouth. This is why in the American culture that we live in, you hear people say, my cancer, my diabetes. You think these are a joke. There are no jokes in the spirit. You have breached the law in the spirit. I'm going to show it to you. You've breached the law. There's a law that you have breached. What is that? A man shall have whatsoever he saith. A man shall have. It's for good or for bad. It doesn't just work on the good side. It's for good or for bad. A man shall have whatsoever he saith. This is how the enemy gains control. This is how he gains it. He injects fear, and then all of a sudden, self-fulfilling prophecy. That whole thing you have taken, you have claimed, and instead of you casting that thought, what do you do with thoughts? Casting down thoughts. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not physical, okay? They are mighty through God to the mighty. The weapons are mighty weapons. They know how to pulling down false imaginations. The word imaginations means image formations. Image formations. You go to bed and you have a dream. You see in that dream that you died in that dream, or in that dream you signed your filling in a pot. The enemy begins to, don't you know the word of God trumps dreams? The word of God trumps visions. Visions and dreams are subject to the word of God. You don't have to accept every dream. You have the legal right to reject whatever dream you want to reject. See, but people don't know this. So they take their thoughts. The Bible says, take thoughts captive. Take the thought. Don't let it pass your security checkpoint. Don't let thoughts, flashes, false images, demonic images that are sent from the pit of hell, okay, dominate your thoughts. You take these thoughts captive. You check them. You check them because thoughts do manifest. Think about it this way. Is there anything that happens in this world that didn't originate with a thought? There is no decision without a thought. There's no decisions without thoughts. Okay? And there are no actions without decisions. So when you trace actions, all actions are rooted in a thought. Don't play with this, right? So the enemy understands that realm of the mind, and he knows how to flash it. He knows how to inject it. And then he waits for you to take that thought and claim it. And that gives him the legal right to begin his havoc. And how does he do it? On the platform of lies. That's why he's called the father of lies. He takes part of the word, he will twist it, confuse you, and all of a sudden your life starts going down from there. This is how he fights. And we have to learn how to respond better. Okay? So when we talk about faith, listen to me now. You want the enemy to be fully subject to you in real time. You need to develop your faith in that area. You want to walk in divine health, you need to develop your faith in that area. Whatever it is you want to do in any area of your life, you need to develop your faith in that area. We're going to move this to next Sunday, right? Let me come to you next Sunday. I wasn't really going to even come here tonight. Come on in. Oh, Boo is ready to go for dinner. Hey, son. How are you? You want to say hello to the people? You want to say hello to the people?
Hi, people.
It's daddy and mommy's boy right here, right? Hey, Chitalam, you want to say hello? They want to see your face.
He's being shy.
Hello, he's been shy. He's just,
yeah, I was looking for my
phone. Always like this. Yeah, he's here. All right, well, baby, prayers out. Prayers out. Before she does that, let me just do this very quickly. Type in the name of your loved ones. If you haven't made Jesus the Lord of your life, pray this simple prayer with me. You say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Be the Savior of my soul and the Lord of my life. I believe with all my heart that God raised you from the dead. With my mouth, I declare you to be the Son of the living God and the Lord over my life. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for shedding your precious blood. Thank you for washing every sin of mine away through that precious blood. I receive from you the gift of eternal life. I believe I'm born again. I believe I'm saved. I believe I'm a child of the King. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Amen. And if you pray that prayer, I promise you, you are now born again, right? Now, do me a favor. Just send me an email at info@633movement.com. And let us help you with your next steps while you stay connected to us, you know, almost every day of the week now, Monday through Fridays on the Warrior Nation channel, 6 a.m. U.S. Central Time, Saturday mornings Bible class on the M63 channel, and of course, Sunday night, 6 p.m. on the M63 channel. Please go and register for camp. I can't say this more than enough. Go and register for camp. You go to 633movement.com. Go there now and register. The time is running. I promise you, there is no way your life will be the same. We've got amazing people coming from all over the world to participate in this camp, all right? So you want to be there. Now, those of you who want to give an offering, please, you can go to, those of you on Facebook, go to our blue Contact Us button, and you can give on our Givelify page. It take you to our Givelify page, and you can give that way. The ministry's Cash App. Help us. We're preaching the gospel around the world through the 1 billion soul mandate. And we've got something exciting coming out very soon, hopefully in the beginning of the new year. Our internet radio, that will be, you hear Kelly and I, our messages 24 hours a day. As long as you got internet from anywhere in the world, you'll be able to hear, like the message you just heard now, you'll be hearing it all through 24 hours a day. I mean, so we're building that. It's costing a lot of money to build that. So give with that in mind. Those of you who want to give, PayPal, the ministry's Cash App is 1 billion souls. So give that way, 1 billion souls. You can give that way. And God will bless you for it. PayPal is paypal.me. Thank you, Naomi, for putting a personal Cash App. If you want to bless Kelly and I, you can give also my personal Cash App. That's hashtag Sino Agueze, SinoAgueze. And then also, PayPal is paypal.me/633LIFE. You can give that way. P.O. Box 16630 Jackson, Mississippi 39236. Or just go to my website, 633movement.com. Click on the donate button. It will show you all the ways you can give. There is no single way that is not conducive for all of you to give something tonight. So into this world. And let's come prepared next Sunday night. It's going to be explosive. But Kelly will be here with you all, maybe two of us together tomorrow morning at Monday. We'll bring a fresh word to you all also, okay? All right. Baby, come over and pray. Pray for people who are giving. And then we'll let you all go, okay?
Okay. Father, okay. We just want to thank you so much for everyone who's given tonight. God, we thank you that your word says that the generous will prosper and those who refresh others shall be refreshed. God, we declare that the pockets of your people will never be empty, Lord. We honor you. We praise you. Thank you for always giving seed to the sower. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, people. Echislam, you want to say he's just busy playing with the wife. Okay.
Come on,
okay.
My man. Say bye-bye.
You want to say bye-bye? Look at you there. Look, people are looking at you. You want to say bye-bye? Echislam, you want to say bye-bye? Okay. He's in another zone. Love you all. See you next Sunday. God bless you.
Bye, y'all.
Bye.
Okay, Sam. Okay. Hold on. He's coming. Hold on.